For the last 10 days, I've been touring an absolute who's who of Shenzhen's top 3D printing companies. And in this video, I'm going to share exclusive behind-the-scenes footage, never-before-seen products, all the secrets I was able to dig up, and my bottom-line conclusions about what has arguably become the epicenter of 3D printing innovation and manufacturing. Let's get after it. So, as we speak, I'm locked down in a hotel in Shenzhen's beautiful and trendy Nanshan district, which honestly has been great. I actually wouldn't have any complaints about being stuck here a few more days if it weren't for the fact that, as you can probably hear in the background, we're actually stuck in our hotel room with two young children under the age of 3, no daycare, and a sick mommy who is very ready to go back to work. Yes, that's right. When AnyCubic reached out to me about a month ago, offering to pay for my flights and hotel accommodations so that I could attend a series of events for their 8th anniversary celebration in China, I thought to myself, sounds like an adventure. Why not bring my wife and kids? And despite the fact that doing so might seem crazy, and they honestly advised against it, believe it or not, my wife and I have been blown away by how kid-friendly the city really is. And overall, we've had a lot of fun taking our kids to all the different sites, but that's probably not why you're here, so let's dive into the behind-the-scenes tours, shall we? Oh, and if at any point you're not interested in a specific manufacturer or tour, remember that you can just use the chapters below to skip around. Okay, here we go. Right off the bat, upon reaching Shenzhen from Hong Kong via the bullet train, I sent my family off to rest in the hotel and hopped in a cab to LDO Motors, which fittingly was actually the first company ever to agree to send me a review printer when I was just starting out. So they really have a bit of a special place in my heart for sure. When I arrived, I met Sue, Rebecca, and a few other members of the team because Jason and LDO's other co-founder are both abroad attending various festivals and trade shows. It's important to note that this office is not their main factory where the actual manufacturing is done, but rather their R&D and sales offices where only some assembly, packaging, and shipping are done. This is going to be a common theme throughout the video because, as I learned, Shenzhen itself, especially the nicer areas, has really become extremely expensive. So while some newer companies will do everything in one location, maybe in a cheaper part of town, the larger companies have moved their factories an hour or two inland or even to entirely different cities. Once I arrived at LDO's office, they showed me around their showroom, which had a few exciting surprises that I haven't actually seen before. One cool thing that I learned about LDO is that even the sales and support staff are expected to build their own Voron machines, so that they'll better understand the products they spend every day talking about. And it was so cool to see some of the personalized Vorons that different staff members had proudly built. Then I got to meet a bunch of the engineers working on designs and improvements on LDO's present and future products. I even got to see the current working prototype of the Positron V3, which honestly blew my mind, but as you might imagine, I wasn't permitted to film it. But rest assured, I think you guys are going to be really impressed when you do get to see it. Then it was off to one of the warehouse and assembly areas to see where LDO packages and stores the various components of their kits. We are in LDO's warehouse now, and I just learned that their quality control manager is former Foxconn, so he's considered like really expert in the field of quality control. And I want you guys to see just how meticulously everything is organized. There's not, oh, I found one box out of place. There's one box here out of place. But other than that, everything is perfectly in its perfect place. Not a single box unlabeled, not a single box out of place. You've got all the Voron 0.2s here. You've got the linear rails, the aluminum extrusions. This is absolutely incredible just to see how many 3D printers are coming through here, and everything is already labeled and branded and perfectly ready to go. Here we have a bunch of E3D Revo packs. Really, really cool to see just how all the kits come together and where they're stored before they come out to all of you. While there is almost no manufacturing done at this facility, I did get to see how the kits are packed and assembled, and how some products, such as the Orbiter Extruder series, are assembled for shipping. From there, it was time to bid my friends at LDO goodbye and head off to my next meeting at BIQU and BigTreeTech. Yes, for those of you who don't know, BIQU and BigTreeTech are two divisions of the same company, one focusing on full 3D printers and the other on boards, components, and upgrades. There, I met Richard, a really cool young guy who spent 8 years studying in the US and helped with the language barrier, and Eric, the founder of the company. I also got to see their truly beautiful showroom and display area, which would also become something of a theme as I visited many of the more established companies. As I sat in the conference room, Richard and Eric started bringing in a series of progressively more exciting new and unreleased products for me to photograph. These included their new smart filament sensor, which senses clogs and jams, to new boards and drivers, and even their new extruder and hot end combination, developed in collaboration with E3D to extract incredibly high flow values from the new E3D Revo high flow system. I got a chance to check out their sales and support offices, their photography room, and then even their engineering and R&D departments, as well as their secret testing lab and workshop. Here, there were a few things that even I wasn't allowed to see or even photograph, but it was definitely very cool to watch how engineers literally design complicated parts like control boards from scratch. At this point, I thought the tour was over and I packed up my video gear. But then Eric smirked, looked at Richard, and asked him a question in Chinese, which Richard translated. Do you want to see some top secret products now? Obviously, I can't tell you anything about the three or four products I saw next. I alluded to them in my Insider Info newsletter that I sent out to my Patreon supporters, but even there, I'm not able to share any real details. All I can say is that I'm extremely excited about these products. I'm quite confident that many, many thousands of you are going to want to buy them. And I made both Eric and Richard promise me that I'll be one of the first reviewers to try them out when they do come out. So make sure to smash that subscribe button if you want to be one of the first to know about those products when they come out. From there, we headed off to a ridiculously delicious dinner where we chatted about the state of the industry, innovation, marketing, competition, and more. And I headed home after a long day to help my wife with the kids and rest up for another long day. The following day, I hopped in an early morning taxi headed to Creality, where I was surprised to meet Sabrina, Chris, and myself. Creality was so sweet. They decorated the lobby and the entrances to their office with my ugly mug to welcome me. Here, once again, I learned that I would be only touring Creality's offices and labs because their factories, which span many, many buildings, are actually located quite far away in Wuhan. I didn't have time in this trip to head out there, but I did hear that Sam Prentice did a full factory tour, so check out his channel if you want to see that. At Creality, I saw a lot of very interesting things. We started out by visiting their truly jaw-dropping museum. Yes, you heard that right, which exhibits the history of many of Creality's 3D printers, as well as their technological accomplishments, awards, accolades, and patents. I saw a lot of incredible projects and printers, many of which I never knew Creality made. Then we headed into Creality's Experience Center, one of two such centers where row after row of K1 and K1 Max were set up for anyone to come in and either use during scheduled classes and workshops or just on their own time. I honestly thought that this was maybe a bit of a gimmick or a ploy, or that I didn't understand them correctly when they said that anyone could come in and use the printers. But while I was there, I actually got a chance to hang out with a couple young kids who just wandered in with their grandma during vacation. With the help of Sabrina, I actually got to explain to them the fundamentals of 3D printing, which was really, really exciting for me. I also got to hang out with James, a young guy whose father, Jesse, is the coordinator of Creality's employee health and wellness clubs. So James is really quite a regular at the offices, and I learned that he attends just about every one of the workshops he possibly can, and he's become really quite a skilled 3D modeler as a result. As you can imagine, Creality is a pretty big place, occupying, I think, 7 or 8 floors just for sales, R&D, support, and logistics. I got a chance to see their large open office spaces where the various sales and marketing people work, interview a few of their people about their work at Creality, and even meet Creality's official 3D designer, who showed me some of the workshop areas where any Creality employee can print out whatever they want, and some of his own personal pet projects that he's most proud of. Then we headed over to the ecosystem R&D team, which is in charge of developing and testing everything besides 3D printers, such as filament, lasers, filament dryers, and so on. At this point, you might be noticing a trend if you've been paying careful attention to the B-roll. Everywhere I went, there were Bamboo Lab printers out in the open, either fully assembled or in pieces. No matter what company I visited, every single one of them was either developing products for Bamboo Lab printers to compete with them, or testing their existing product lineup for compatibility. Whether you love Bamboo Lab or hate them, it's hard to deny the fact that they've had a huge impact on the industry when you see just how prevalent their products are in every single R&D department in the industry. So make sure you're subscribed, because in the next video, we're gonna tour there as well. Before leaving Creality, I also met the team from PyoCreate, a division of Creality focused on large-scale industrial pellet 3D printers, and tried out some of their products. Then, Sabrina took me to a large conference room where I got the opportunity to sit down with Ralph and Zidane, two software and firmware engineers responsible for such products as the SonicPad, the K1, and the K1 Max. I was super impressed by what happened next. Sabrina informed me that the team had all seen my review of the K1 and that they were committed to making the product better. So for the next half an hour, and over the following, again, ridiculously delicious lunch that the entire team treated me to, we talked about all of my various gripes with the K1 and how and why Creality could resolve them for its users. I let them know my real thoughts about their stripped-down version of Fluid, both philosophically and ethically, given that it's based on the open-source Clipper, and in terms of user experience, and I was pleasantly surprised to hear that Creality fully intends to make things right. They asked me that I not go into any specific details about the timelines or the exact strategy of how they're going to execute on this, so we'll have to wait and see, but personally, I believe them at face value, and I definitely look forward to testing the K1 Max sometime soon as a result of what I learned and saw. After a whirlwind tour at Creality, I hopped over to the folks at FYSETC, which was definitely a very different experience. First of all, as you can imagine, FYSETC is a much smaller company working on much more niche products than Creality. Second of all, this was the first company I visited where there was no foreign educated staff member who could act as a translator. Overall, we got by just fine, but I was definitely glad to have some of those translating apps on my phone. FYSETC started off my visit by immediately bringing in a parade of unreleased products into their conference room, which also had a pretty cool display case showing the history of their products. For those of you who don't know, FYSETC kind of cut their teeth making Prusa clones and selling them on AliExpress. But these days, the majority of their business seems to be selling Voron kits and Voron upgrade parts. And I will say to their credit that they seem to have moved past the clone parts market and into developing their own innovative products, which I honestly didn't see anywhere else. These include these lightweight linear rails for Voron kits, these beautiful CNC'd aluminum extrusions, this CNC'd carbon fiber Voron tap kit, and these super cool macro push buttons that can be customized and programmed to perform any function on your Voron or Clipper 3D printer. I even saw some products that I've seen elsewhere but didn't know that FYSETC carried, such as CNC parts for my Voron 2.4 and 0.2. Other innovative products I saw included this new PEI build surface for belt printers, a super ingenious accelerometer that mounts to any nozzle without needing additional hardware, and more. Even the more clone-type products, like this new Prusa-style enclosure, are not direct clones, and I was told that this enclosure offers many more features than the official Prusa one, such as built-in lighting, filtration, and macro buttons outside for a fraction of the price. Here, again, FYSETC doesn't do all their manufacturing in this facility, they just have a small print farm and assembly facility, and they offered to take me over to their main factory, but I had to get back to my wife and kids for baths and bedtime. Maybe next visit. In any case, I met many members of the FYSETC team, including my representative Sarah and their lead engineer, and more, and it was a really productive visit. I'm really hoping that FYSETC will open up an affiliate program to their main web store, because right now the only way I can link to their products is through AliExpress, which I tried to explain to them has this kind of cheap negative connotation among Western consumers. All right, guys, apparently we are going into lockdown in like less than an hour here, so I really need to figure out how I can order some food and stuff so my family doesn't, you know, starve during the typhoon. Plus, this video is getting just a little bit long, but not to worry, I toured another 6 companies during my time here, including Bamboo Lab, Anycubic, Sovel, Comgrow, Cybor, PCBWay, plus I attended Formnext South China. And I'm going to put up another video all about that later this week, as soon as I can upload all the footage through a VPN. So if you're not already subscribed, please make sure to do that so you don't miss out. And even if you are, consider hitting the bell icon so you don't miss out on future videos. I'd also love to hear in the comments below what you thought about this video and how I can improve the next one. Oh, and before I let you go, I do need to take a quick moment to give a huge thank you to Anycubic, who not only sponsored my trip to China by paying my airfare and hotel, but who also was kind enough to sponsor this week's video so that I could let you know about all the upcoming Anycubic Cobra 2 series printers. That includes the Anycubic Cobra 2 Pro, the Cobra 2 Max, the Cobra 2 Neo, and the Cobra 2 Plus. These printers represent a new generation of Anycubic printers, which offer high-quality, reliable hardware, convenience features like automated bed leveling and touchscreens, all paired with Anycubic's own easy-to-use, high-speed firmware. And let me tell you, having played around with them here, both during my tour of Anycubic and at Formnext Shenzhen, these things are fast. They leverage the same type of input shaping that is so advanced and high-performing as Clipper, but without the need to learn the ins and outs of Clipper, which I know will be a selling point for those of you who don't enjoy tinkering around with software. Best of all, 3 out of 4 printers include Wi-Fi, and there is a size and price point for everyone, from the extremely competitive Cobra 2 Neo at just $159 to pre-order, to the behemoth Cobra 2 Max, which at $479 for a 420 by 420 by 500 build volume is honestly pretty hard to beat. So to check out Anycubic and support the people who made this entire video series possible, visit the link in the description or go to jle.vi/Anycubic. Thanks again to Anycubic for making this video possible. And if you haven't had a chance to check out my full interview with Anycubic's co-founder, Dr. James Ouyang, please make sure to do so because it was a truly awesome conversation. Oh, and of course, thanks to all my Patreon supporters who've been getting exclusive behind-the-scenes photos and leaks throughout this entire process. I really appreciate you guys. That's all for this one, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.